Everybody, Tofolcher of Galergadi on Down and Oshuntana Heron. You're all very welcome to the National Gallery of Ireland, and our thanks to the Chairman, Dr. Olive Braden, for her very kind welcome, and also to my colleague, Margarita Sani. As you can see on the screen, the symposium Future Forecasting was held last autumn, and the purpose of that symposium was to open the dialogue, to open the discussion on the challenges facing museums. Why? Because we had done a number of questionnaire surveys, and this seemed to be the thing that was coming up. The feeling was that the world was a very volatile place and that there was a need to just look at what the challenges were coming ahead. The symposium aims to draw this conversation to a close, but not a conclusion. Clearly, this is a subject that is going to exercise minds for quite some time to come. Just to let you know that the proceedings of the symposium and the roundtable will be published this year. Also, if I can remember to turn this, just to let you know that any images that you're seeing in the background here have no particular significance. They're to remind us that we are here today to talk about the challenges facing museums in the coming times. Underpinning the challenges facing museums today is the severe economic downturn. And while we feel in Ireland that the economic downturn is affecting us very severely, the reality is that if you travel overseas, you see it's impacting just as badly elsewhere. So what are the main issues, some of which were addressed at the symposium? One, primarily financial constraints. A range of cuts of varying degrees so severe that some museums have closed. Museums have reduced opening hours, some have cut out evening openings, and others have closed an extra day a week. But of course, museums have to be well managed and have to be creative about using existing resources. Two, staff cuts. They have been the next casualty, either through letting staff go or the jobs embargo. The result is that fewer people are doing more jobs. Room closures and retail outlets are losing income that goes back into the museum through the lack of visitors. However, it behoves museums to make use of volunteer programs and internships. The result of all of this downturn and curtailing of services for some museums is an inability to maintain a quality service. However, the symposium identified the need for museums to be creative in our thinking, consult colleagues outside the sector who might provide training, advice, opportunities, or even role models, and to adopt a fresh approach to generating income, because this helps to maintain a standard of service. Now, some of you may have noticed that the title of my presentation is Key Trends in Museums of the Future, and that relates to the small group in the Learning Museum Network project that we had been asked to coordinate. It's about key trends in museums of the future. And this part of this key trends group, one of the things that they did was to organize a survey, a European-wide survey. In fact, it's not European-wide, it's worldwide survey, which asked museums in 2011 to comment on anything in the museum that was declining, anything in the museum that was ongoing, holding its own, and anything that they considered to be a new trend. The declining areas, and this is interesting, now this is a survey with particular results. I'm not saying that this survey would accord with everything in your experience. I'm just saying that we were quite interested that the survey produced certain kinds of results, and we will be discussing this afternoon at a different forum as to what we will do following on from the survey. But however, the declining areas that the survey noted were audio guides and evening openings. And by way of explanation for this, the responses indicated that museums had problems with installing the technology to run the guides, they were not in the position to employ anyone to manage them, and they could not afford to give them away as many museums do, such as we do. So for some museums, it was a cost factor. In terms of the evening hours, the same issues applied. There was no funding available to employ staff to do evening duty or to cover the cost of keeping the museum open. Tours, conducted tours, also fitted into this category because they could not afford to pay the guides. Now, it's a particular kind of result. On the positive side, there were positive highlights listed by this survey. And the positive points made were an increased demand for exhibitions, number one, two, social media, new technology, and three, the use of educational events as an essential way to engage the public in the museum. By way of explanation of these points, and when I say by way of explanation, the comments that the survey revealed as to why people explained these results, number one, museums said they needed temporary exhibitions, in-focus shows, and changing displays because they bring in new audiences. They also referred to regular and repeat audiences who are demanding greater variation in the permanent collections and the temporary displays. So there is a need to refurbish what we put on display to engage audiences. While this is to the advantage of the museum to know this information, it has to be resourced. And without staff, it is not possible to mount shows. And without a budget, it is not possible to advertise and promote the displays that entice the public to visit the museum. Secondly, museums noted the massive increase in the use of new technology, example, digital media and social networking, and how social networking has increased interest and promotion of museums. The survey also needed the note to use technology in every area of the operation. So it wasn't just in certain areas of the operation, the website or whatever. The survey was pointing out the fact that there was a much greater use need for technology to be used everywhere in the museum. The survey also, of course, we're very well aware of the fact that online resources such as websites require considerable funding to set them up, require more funding to maintain them, and even more funding, and often a lot more funding, to develop them. So we're back pretty much to the same problem. And then the third point that was mentioned, educational and entertaining events and activities, were identified as critical in helping the public to engage with the museum. However, public programming has taken a hit, with quite a number of museums considerably reducing services to the bare minimum due to budgetary cuts. And what is the result of that? Well, the result of that is a loss of visitors. To wrap up on my own presentation, I wanted to make just a small comment. I'm reminded of a comment made by an American museologist, Elaine Human Gurian, who spoke at an Irish Museums conference in Derry a couple of years ago, and she titled her presentation as Museums as Soup Kitchens. And what she meant by that was that when things are tough, when we're in difficult times, that it's important to find ways to encourage the museum, to encourage the local community to use the museum. Example, she gave examples at that particular conference. She said, for example, you could invite local communities or courses, whatever, to run archaeology courses, art classes for children, to hold meetings in the seminar rooms in the museum, or to hold particular kinds of events, which a lot of us are doing anyway. But she was saying, because a museum that is linked to and engaged with its community, because a museum that is engaged with and linked to the community will have a community that will want to help, protect, and defend that museum. It was a very strong comment to say that if you are servicing your community very well and bringing them in to actually use your facilities, then that's the community that is going to help you, protect you, and defend you. And ever was there a time when we need that help and defence now. So as I wrap up to a conclusion, I wanted to just say to you today, can museums demonstrate creative thinking, energy, and new ideas? Well, we have great speakers, a fantastic audience, not just on site here in the gallery, but also online. So let's see what the Museum of the Future looks like. I will hand you over to Professor Kathleen James Chakrabarty, who is going to chair the morning. Thank you very much.